Okay, in the last lecture, we have discussed fundamentals of sintering and properties of ceramic, bioceramic materials, particularly that how these materials can be fabricated using the sintering techniques and how their mechanical properties are different from that of metals and what are the different toughening mechanisms, how you can characterize the ceramic materials in terms of strength, toughness, hardness properties, elastic modulus properties and so on. Now, in this lecture, I'll focus on the discussion of the one of the new alternative phosphate materials, that is potassium magnesium phosphates. So this material has been developed as an alternative to hydroxyapatite materials. Now remember, the hydroxyapatite has a typical formula is Ca10PO4⁬OH⁄2. Okay? Now, this hydroxyapatite is one of the important phosphate materials which has been widely now recognized for biomedical applications. So, in next set of slides, I will show you that how an alternate phosphate materials can be developed based on different inorganic composition and how these materials can have equally good cytocompatible properties like that of hydroxyapatite. So, as I say that hydroxyapatite is an important biophosphate material. So, MKP as a magnesium potassium phosphate as a phosphate material, and then hardly any research has been carried out on these phosphate materials for biomedical applications. And therefore, we have investigated this material in our laboratory, and these particularly chemically bonded phosphate ceramics are essentially based on this magnesium potassium phosphate systems. They have been used, or people have reported their use, particularly in nuclear waste removal applications, nothing to do with the biomedical applications in the past. Now, how this material was prepared? You start with the precursor powders, magnesium oxide, then K2PO4. And magnesium oxide, they are mixed together in an aqueous solution, and then you get this magnesium potassium phosphate, and this magnesium potassium phosphate is an hydrated magnesium potassium phosphate materials. Now delta G values here, it is largely negative, so it is almost like -970 kilojoule per mole at 25 degree Celsius. Now if delta G value is negative, that means this reaction is thermodynamically feasible, right? And this is number one point. Number two point is that you can start with a fairly coarse magnesium oxide particles and fairly, and you can mix together. And this particular study has been taken where 50% silica filter has been added in the dry powder mixer. Now, why silica has been added to this powder mixer? The silica has been added to this magnesium oxide and K2PO4, so that silica essentially acts as a chemical bonding agent, so that silica will bond this magnesium potassium phosphate H2O in the particular ceramic matrix. And this has, as I said, that this has been already used in the treatment of high level nuclear waste like technetium, mercury or heavy metals like lead, cadmium and nickel. So, this has been already published in Journal of Nuclear Materials by a group of researchers from Argonne National Laboratory, United States. And therefore, this is the particular, you know, processing technique that has been developed and which has been used to make this magnesium phosphate. But remember, this has 6H2O, so it is like a hydrated magnesium potassium phosphate materials. Now, what we have done then in the as cast, first we have done this materials, we have processed this materials using slip casting. After the slip casting, we have done the heat treatment of this material at different temperature, and this temperature was chosen somewhere around 900 to 1100 degree Celsius, and heat treatment time was initially optimized, and then optimized time was 4 hours. And how this heat treatment time was optimized? Initially, researchers have carried out the experiments from 2 to 8 hours at regular interval of 2 hours. So, 2 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours. Then they have found that 4 hours is the optimum heat treatment time, and therefore, further experiments were carried out at this temperature range for 4 hours. XRD was taken to find out that what are the different phase assemblage. FTIR was essentially to find out that what the phosphate group is there and which minus vibration peak is there or not. Raman spectra has been used, or Raman spectroscopy results were used to provide complementary information to the XRD results, so that you know you can confidently say that presence of certain phases. Cytocompatibility was studied using that L99 cell lines, and also MTT assay was carried out to quantify the cell viability of these materials. Now, as I said, that these materials were heat treated at 3 different temperatures for 4 hours. As you see, that MKP1 has a very low density, and that is because of the high level of porosity in the structure. Now, when you heated them at 900 to 1100 degrees Celsius, this material has a largely equal density, or almost like identical density, which is close to around 2.5 gram per cc. Okay? Now, 2.5 gram per cc density essentially tells you that this material has a very low density, and these low density materials can be obtained in this magnesium phosphate materials. As I said in the beginning of this course, that typically density is also one of the important factor. If the density is large, then the patient will feel quite heavy, and because of the large weight implants. But if the density is low, then the patient will find also, you know, that these very lightweight implant materials. So that is the reason that, you know, density was very low. The density, low density materials is preferred. Now, XRD results essentially tells you that there are peaks which corresponds to a K2MgSi5O12. So this is the K2MgSi5O12. Now, these peaks are the most intense peaks here. That is the 100% intense peaks. Also, MgKPO4 peaks or MgKPO46H2O peaks are present in that ascust condition. So, this is like your ascust phase, and this is like 900 degrees Celsius sinter, this is 1000, this is 1100 degrees Celsius heat treated conditions. Okay? So, these are like 3 different temperatures these materials were heat treated. And then what you see essentially that these peaks, that MgKPO46H2O has disappeared in this when you are sintering at higher temperature. And then the large silicate peaks, that K2MgSi5O12, has been formed. So that shows that MgKPO4 must have reacted with your silica, which is present in large amount in the starting powder mix, to form this particular silicate phase. Now, this is the reaction we have proposed, that which essentially tells you that why K2MgSi5O12 phase is formed, and then what should be the reaction, and that reaction has also involved SiO2 phase. The major peaks that has been detected for these samples, which are already identified SiO2, that comes from the precursor powder mix MgKPO4, because that H2 has been released because of the heat treatment conditions at a high temperature. And then K2MgSi5O12, that comes from this particular reactions, that is between SiO2 and MgKPO4. Now, FTIR spectra essentially tells you that you have this pure phosphate peak in this material, and also you have some OH minus vibration peak, which is roughly around here. So, this is your OH minus vibration peak essentially tells you that this material has some hydrated phosphate phase, and this phosphate phase essentially indicates that, you know, you have that MgKPO4 also, because you have the silicate phase, you have the also the MgKPO4 phase also. Silicate peak essentially is coming from this particular place. So, this is also that your silicate phase is there. This is phosphate and silicate, they almost like overlap. So, PO4 minus 3 and SiO4 4 minus, these peaks, these FTIR bands overlap, and essentially this region indicates that you have a phosphate peak as well as the silicate peak also. And if you go back and correlate with your XRD results, then that correlates well, because that correlation sounds very perfect, because you have this K2MgSi5O12, that is a silicate phase, and also you have the MgKPO4, that is also phosphate phase. So, essentially from the FTIR also, you should essentially find that there is the presence of the phosphate peak as well as a silicate peak, and exactly that is what you are seeing in this FTIR band. Now, Raman spectroscopy results essentially shows you that pure hydroxyapatite, you have a phosphate peak here, and in this MgKPO4 phase also, that in the starting powder itself or in the prior to the heat treatment, you have this MKP1, and then prior to the heat treatment, your peak intensity is fairly low. But when you are heat treating at 900,000 and 1100 degrees Celsius, then your phosphate peaks also becomes more prominent. And therefore, these phosphate peaks are in line with the phosphate peaks of your calcium phosphate, calcium hydro Ca10PO4O6OH2, that is your hydroxyapatite phase. So, this presence of this phosphate peak is quite important here. The other important thing is that alpha quartz. Alpha quartz is comes from your silica peak, and this alpha quartz phase also present in this MKP1 to MKP4 materials, and that is even after the heat treatment also you have the significant amount of silica in the materials. Now, as I have shown you earlier that during this in vitro biocompatibility assessment, that this standard protocol is followed in our laboratory to find out the cell culture study, to assess the cell culture behavior, as well as we have used also standard biochemical assays, and that is a combination of MTT, ALP and osteocalcin. So, the standard biochemical assays has been also used to find out, but in this particular case we have only used that MTT just to quantitatively state that what is the cell viability property of these materials. Now, this cell adhesion property what you are seeing here, here you can clearly see that this MKP, that is magnesium potassium phosphate, which is heated at 1100 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. This is the L929 cells, and you can see the phyllopodia extension very clearly in this material. Now, if you compare with this and this, what you have seen in the pure hydroxyapatite also, that your phyllopodia extension and the cell adhesion property is quite similar, or it is very much comparable and as comparable with the control disc. So, therefore, you can qualitatively say, not quantitatively, that MKP material which you have, which we have developed, they have comparable cell adhesion property as like that of the hydroxyapatite. So, this is some comments based on the actually what I have just told you. We have further carried out that MTT assay, and this MTT assay, as you know, that it quantitatively state you that what is the cell viability property in this materials. So, this is prior to the heat treatment, this is 900,000 and 1100 degrees Celsius, and this is metabolically active cells, that means your MTT reagent actually reacts with the mitochondria of the cells, and that gives you that what is the total number of metabolically active cells present on the material. And then what you see, their error bars actually overlap with each other. Now, if the error bars overlap with each other, that shows that they have a statistically similar level of MTT values. There is no statistically significant difference among all these materials. And also, it tells you that since percentage pure HAP is plotted along the y axis, so it is comparable with that of the pure hydroxyapatite, that MTT values, or in some materials is little higher than that of the pure hydroxyapatite values. So, that is very good, because you are developing, you are proposing an alternative phosphate materials where the MTT values after culturing with L929 cells, that shows like, you know, good cytocompatibility property as well as good cell viability property like that of pure hydroxyapatite. Now, why we think that, you know, that these materials have a good biocompatibility property? Now, there are some literature reports mostly from Chinese researchers, and then what they have found, that for the Ca2SiO4, that calcium silicate materials, they have reported good bioactivity and biocompatibility and mechanical properties. Also, another group led by Wu, and they have also reported that there is a one particular complex silicate phase, that Ca7MgSi4O16, and that ceramic for biomedical application, because this ceramic showed evidences of the good osteoblast proliferation. And from this literature, we believe that the our materials, which has a combination of the magnesium phosphate phase and silicate phase. Now, phosphate phase is already well known that it should have a good biocompatibility property, that you know from your Ca10PO4O6OH2, because hydroxyapatite has good biocompatibility property. So, we are little bit worried that because this has an additional silicate phase, that K2MgSi5O12, that whether the presence of the additional silicate phase will degrade the MTT values or will degrade the cytocompatibility property or not. But what our results show that, you know, the additional presence of this silicate in addition to phosphate essentially gives you comparable cytocompatibility, comparable MTT values like that of the pure hydroxyapatite. Okay? So, these are the conclusions from this part of the study, that is the heat treatment at 904 hours and little bit above, it gives you a density, low density alternative phosphate materials, and this density has around 2.5 gram per cc. XRD analysis confirms the presence of this K2MgSi5O12 as well as the magnesium potassium phosphate phase in these materials, and then complementary information on the phosphate and silicate phases were also obtained by FTIR, that is Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy, as well as the Raman spectroscopy. And MTT analysis of the samples that indicates that, you know, these newly investigated phosphate ceramics are non-cytotoxic as the sintered hydroxyapatite. And on the basis of this good cytocompatibility, spreading and adhesion and proliferation characteristics, we believe that the combination of the slip casting and the heat treatment combination can lead to development of low density biocomposite with non-cytotoxic properties. Today I will be showing you some slides which will demonstrate as how to design the hydroxyapatite based biocomposites with significant bactericidal property. If you recall that hydroxyapatite has two major problems, one is the brittleness, that is the low crack growth resistance or very low fracture toughness, and then second one is that it has lack of bactericidal property or it has lack of antimicrobial property. So therefore, there is a indeed need to improve the antimicrobial property as well as the fracture toughness properties in these materials. Now, there are some questions that will be answered with the help of our experimental results. The first one is that how to optimize the material composition to have a good balance between the bactericidal and cytocompatibility property. Bactericidal means it will kill bacteria, by cytocompatibility means that it will not have any cytotoxicity effect and it will, the cell will proliferate or cell fate processes will be enhanced in contact with these materials. Second one, does the bactericidal property also depend on, does the bactericidal property depend on the type of bacteria? Type of bacteria means there are two type of bacteria. One is that gram negative bacteria, one is that gram positive bacteria. Now, the question is that whether a given material which has good bactericidal property or antimicrobial property against gram negative bacteria, whether the same material will have similarly good bactericidal property against gram positive bacteria or not. That question also needs to be answered. The third one is that does the phase composition, that is the HAP TCP or the mixture of HAP and TCP, have any influence on the bactericidal property? Fourth one is that does the synthesis routine incorporate antimicrobial agent in HAP lattice have any effect on the antimicrobial property? Now, this synthesis route can be either, you can mix these two powders, hydroxyapatite with any antimicrobial agent by mechanical mixing route, or you can mix them via, or you can dope hydroxyapatite with antimicrobial agent by chemical synthesis route. In both the cases, it will be shown that how antimicrobial property can be improved. Now, there are two different routes of synthesis. One is the mechanical mixing using planetary ball milling, and second one is the chemical doping of silver to hydroxyapatite lattice using wet chemistry route. And in these both cases, it will be shown that for the same HAP silver system, now it will be shown for the hydroxyapatite silver system, that how both these routes can equally impart good antimicrobial property in this system. This is the first one, is a mechanically mixed powder. So you take hydroxyapatite with 10% silver, and then you mix it in a planetary ball milling, and thereby after that you sinter them at different temperature right up to 1300 degrees Celsius. What interestingly you see in the X-ray diffraction plots that this hydroxyapatite does not dissociate to tricalcium phosphate even at 1300 degrees Celsius, because you can see characteristic peaks of major characteristic peaks of hydroxyapatite which are present very well at high temperature of 1350 degrees Celsius. Now, if you look this ACM image, what you see at 1200 degrees Celsius, it is more or less porous microstructure. At 1250 and 1300, you can see that silver distribution, and this silver distribution, silver particulates are dispersed more or less homogeneously in this B, that is the 1200 degree Celsius. So this is at 1200 degree Celsius, this is at 1100 degree Celsius, this is at 1250 degree Celsius, and this is at 1300 degree Celsius. Now you do notice certain differences in the distribution of the silver or the shape or morphology of the silver. What is this difference? At 1250 degree Celsius, you see that silver clusters are forming, or silvers are forming some aggregates in the 1250 degree Celsius. However, 1300 degree Celsius, what you see that silvers are clearly distributed along the grain boundary region. Do you notice that, you know, bright silver face, they are clearly distributed in the grain boundary region. So these are the like a distribution part. At 1200 degree Celsius, what you see here that the silvers are homogeneously distributed as individual particulates, not essentially at the grain boundaries, but at different location, microstructural locations within the grains. Now we have done some initial study on the cytocompatibility or the cell fate processes. Now first one, we have done the MTT test. Now as you know, this MTT test is largely used for cell viability or for assessing the cell viability. Now here we have done the pure hydroxyapatite and have 10% silver. Now what you notice that their error bars slightly overlap with each other. That means that as far as the cell viability is concerned, the 10% silver does not affect to any statistically significant manner as in terms of the cell viability property. In other words, the cells are as viable in the hydroxyapatite like the way they are as viable in the hydroxyapatite 10% silver. The second one is that ALP. Now ALP activity, alkaline phosphate activity, what you see here, this is pure hydroxyapatite after 3 days, and this is hydroxyapatite 10% silver. In both the cases, again these error bars, they overlap, roughly overlap with each other. So you do not see any statistically significant difference. The similar thing you have also noticed at the 7 days. So red ones are 7 days. So after 7 days of culture of this, all these results are obtained with AL99, that is mouse fibroblast cells. So after 3 days and 7 days in culture of that ALP and then osteogenic differentiation activity test, that what we find that there is no difference that you can find which is statistically important when you add 10% silver to the hydroxyapatite. We have done this antimicrobial property, which is the key property that was investigated in this material. Now what you do in the antimicrobial property, that what are the protocols that are used in the antimicrobial property, is that you start with this polishing the pellet, then you do this LSP rough surface measurements, this ultrasonication, subsequently you do the autoclaving. After the autoclaving, you wash by ethanol as well as PBS, that is phosphate buffer solution. Then you put it in that vertical laminar flow. Then you seed the bacteria that you want to seed. Like you can, in our experiments, we have used 3 types of bacteria. One is the gram negative, that is the E. coli bacteria, Escherichia coli. 2 are the gram positive bacteria. They are Staphylococcus epidermidis and Staphylococcus aureus. And after seeding this bacteria there, then we can incubate. And this is the CO2 incubator, and in this CO2 incubator, we'll leave this bacteria culture solution for 4 hours roughly. And after 4 hours, again you have to fix these bacteria cells on the materials, and this fixing is done by PBS again, and then serial dilution, and then you can dry it by critical point dryer. And after critical point dryer, you can use either fluorescence microscopy or scanning electron microscope. Now this is the antimicrobial property of the mechanically mixed powder. This is that, you know, planetary ball mill powder. After that you sinter them. Now this is the E. coli bacteria, rod separate E. coli bacteria, as you can see on the negative control disk. And you have this hydroxyapatite 10% silver composite, which is sintered at 1200 degrees Celsius. And after sintering, you can see that after culturing for the same E. coli bacteria for 4 hours, you do not see any bacteria which is adhering on this material, which it shows that you can only see the remnants of the bacteria or the residue of the bacteria after they are being killed. So therefore, hydroxyapatite 10% silver composite has good antimicrobial property. Now we have done this chemical silver doped hydroxyapatite. We have also carried out the synthesis of the silver doped hydroxyapatite using chemical synthesis route. And using chemical synthesis route, what we have done, we have started with this precursor powder, that is calcium nitrate 4-H2O, silver nitrate, and NH4O2HPO4, and to make this 0.5 molar solution, then we have adopted the typical chemical synthesis route, and then subsequently we sinter them at 1200 degrees Celsius for 2 hours. And this 1200 degrees Celsius, 2 hours after sintering, then you do the XRD to confirm the hydroxyl crystal phase as well as the ACM analysis, etc. And in all these cases, we have used that chemically high purity chemical precursors, and then make sure that we calcine at 800 degrees Celsius 2 hours, so that you get phase pure hydroxyapatite silver powder. Now, apart from X-ray diffraction, we have done this ionic conductivity measurements as well as Raman spectroscopy. And Raman spectroscopy we have done at using argon ion laser with the laser power typically kept at 7 milliwatt, and incident light has a wavelength of 514.5 nanometer. And then we have done this antimicrobial property with the E. coli bacteria as well as other bacteria, as I have mentioned already. Now, these are like, you know, very busy slides, which essentially tells you that CA10, so that when you dope this silver in this hydroxyapatite lattice, that means some amount of calcium will be replaced by silver, and thereby they are being incorporated into the solid solution. Now, when we are sintered at 1200 degrees Celsius or 800 to 1200 degrees Celsius, then what you notice that if you x is equal to 0, at 800 the x equal to 1.5, and then you can see that there are beta tricalcium phosphate at 12 above x is equal to 1.5. So when the replacement or the substitution level, where which is denoted by x, if x is equal to 1.5, then you can form lot of beta tricalcium phosphate. Now, similar observation also been noticed at sintered at, when they are sintered at 1200 degrees Celsius, when x is equal to 0 and x is equal to 1.5. In both the cases, we do see hydroxyapatite, but at the same time, we do see alpha tricalcium phosphate as well as beta tricalcium phosphate. So, what do we notice here? That while substituting into hydroxyapatite lattice by silver, there is potential formation of both alpha tricalcium phosphate and beta tricalcium phosphate, and their formation critically depends on the sintering temperature. The other clear trend that you can notice here from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to 1.5, when you vary this after sintering at 1200 degrees Celsius, the Raman band, which corresponds to OH minus vibration band, what you see very clear OH minus vibration beta at x equal to 0.0, it clearly disappears at x is equal to 1.5. What it means, that OH minus essentially indicates that whether you have hydroxyapatite in the lattice or not. Now, when this OH minus completely vanishes or completely disappears, that essentially tells you that hydroxyapatite is completely lost from the material, and you only have the tricalcium phosphate phase, if you see that phosphate peaks here in this hydroxyapatite lattice. And these are observed at the relatively higher Raman band, Raman shift, like 3400 to 3600 region. Now, this antimicrobial property, as I said, we first checked with the using this E. coli bacteria. Now, these are the materials which are sintered at 800 degrees Celsius, and where that substitution level was varied between x is equal to 0.0 to x is equal to 1.5. Now, if this is x equal to 0.0, what you see, you have this long rod-like bacteria. These are present on the materials. Now, at x is equal to 0.8, we do see some bacteria, but it is much less in number. At x is equal to 1 and x is equal to 1.5, what you notice is you have this silver cube. And this silver cube is coming out of the material, and we have found a number of silver cubes on the surfaces. And this number of silver cubes also increases when you increase the substitution level from x equal to 1 to x is equal to 1.5. Now, this is what you can see here on this biomaterial surface after culturing with the E. coli bacteria. And what we believe, that this presence of the silver cubes essentially kills all the bacteria, as you do not see any evidence of E. coli bacteria on these two surfaces. So, essentially, when you substitute at x is equal to 1.0 or higher level, then these materials have good antimicrobial property. Now, this set of four ACM images essentially tells you that how the cell adhesion on the silver embedded hydroxyapatite, they take place. And this cell adhesion property essentially shows you that this is for pure hydroxyapatite, x is equal to 0, b is x is equal to 0.8, c is x is equal to 1, and d is x is equal to 1.5. Now, what you notice, there is not much difference when you go from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to 1.5, and then cells are equally proliferate, and cells also expand on the material surface by phylopody extension. There is cell to cell bridge formation and cellular network formation, which are equally observed at x is equal to 1.5. So that essentially tells you that you can kill the bacteria at x is equal to 1 or higher level of substitution. At the same time, you can have good cellular fate processes, which are also observed in these materials. Now, next set of composites that were developed to check the antimicrobial property is the hydroxyapatite zinc oxide composite. Now, hydroxyapatite zinc oxide composite, now here the one of the postulate was that whether the addition of the zinc oxide essentially enough to kill all the bacteria. In order to test that hypothesis, we have added the zinc oxide content up to 30 weight percent. Now, these experiments were first set of experiments were carried out using E. coli bacteria, where you can see at x equal to 0 as well as up to C x is equal to 5 or addition of 5% zinc oxide, there the colony formation is equally present. But when you increase the bacteria zinc oxide content up to 20 or 30%, what you see interestingly that the number of bacteria cells are much less at x is equal to 20 or x equal to 30. Essentially indicates that it is possible to improve the zinc oxide antimicrobial property with increase in the zinc oxide content. Now, similar observation was also made using that Staphylococcus aureus, that is the gram-positive bacteria, which are cultured on the half 0.5% zinc oxide, 5% zinc oxide, 7.5 and 10% zinc oxide. And in all these cases, you can see that number of bacterial cells, they are also equally, number of bacterial cells are less, and there is not much bacterial colony which are formed, what you have seen at control disk as well as lower amount of zinc oxide content. So, with increasing zinc oxide content, we do see noticeable change in the antimicrobial or bacterial activity on the material surface. Another bacterial strain that we have used, that is the Staphylococcus epidermidis. So, all the Staphylococcus species are important gram-positive bacteria. So, this is like gram-positive bacteria, GRM, gram-positive bacteria, and these gram-positive bacteria were cultured or were seeded on this hydroxyapatite, series of hydroxyapatite zinc oxide composite. And then again, you have this large colony, and this colony are also present to some extent at the lower amount of zinc oxide content. But at a higher amount of zinc oxide content, this number as well as the colony formation is much, much less significant. I mean, therefore, that these materials which have very high zinc oxide content, they have good antimicrobial property. Now, problem is that with the zinc oxide content, that is the cellular adhesion or cell fate processes which takes place on this half zinc oxide composite. Now, what you notice on this half zinc oxide composite is that this is the control disk, this is a pure half, this is 1.5% zinc oxide, this is 5% zinc oxide, this is 20% zinc oxide, and this is 30% zinc oxide. Now, both 20 and 30 you cannot use for any applications which require good cytocompatibility property, because what you see here, the cells are much spherical in shape, which essentially indicates that all the cells are apoptotic or all the cells have died in contact with higher amount of zinc oxide. However, at lower amount of zinc oxide, up to 5-8% zinc oxide, we do see the cell proliferation and cell fate processes which are comparable with the control or with the pure hydroxyapatite material. So, next topic that I would like to discuss that relates to the materials for dental restorative applications. And these dental restorative applications, the materials, these were developed in our laboratory, is that glass ceramic based materials. And I want to show you that, you know, how the base glass composition, if that changes and if the heat treatment condition changes, then how that changes the microstructure in these materials and cytotoxicity and antimicrobial property of this material. Now the system that we have worked, which is very similar to that of the macro glass ceramics, and this is fluoromica glass ceramics, and this is SiO2, MgOl, 2O3, K2O, B2O3, fluorine. And this mica-containing glass ceramics, they are highly machinable. So therefore, because the human tooth has different complex shape, so whatever materials that you try to develop, that needs to be machined to give particular shape. And therefore, this increased versatility of the finished shape is only possible if the material is highly machinable. Then microstructure, typically they contain the randomly oriented, you can see here, this is the transmission network micrograph. And this transmission network micrograph, you see that the essentially this is your glass matrix and this is your crystals, okay? And these crystals are randomly oriented and they are mostly the interlocked or sheet-like crystals. And these crystals are trisilicic fluoropolycarbonate mica crystals, and they are present in a borosilicate glass matrix, okay? It is fascinating to note here that in this particular glass ceramic system, you can develop different morphology of the crystals. For example, this morphology is called the cabbage-shaped morphology, okay? This looks like more like a cabbage, right? Cabbage is a vegetable. And in this cabbage-shaped morphology is observed by change or can be developed in these materials by changing the heat treatment conditions. This is the characteristic structure of these crystals. And what you see, this characteristic structure, the potassium is characteristically located at the central region of this lattice. And then you have this SiO4 silicate tetrahedron, and then your fluorine and magnesium are located in between the silicate tetrahedron. Now there are different type of commercially available machinable glass ceramics are present. One is the macro glass ceramic, and where the crystals, they have a typical composition KMG3, ALSi3, O10F2, and you have the dicor glass ceramics. Again, that although the crystal phase has similar type of composition, but it's slightly different in terms of that it has a KMG2.5 ALSi4 O10F2. And what you notice in this kind of glass ceramic, the crystalline phase which is formed, which is a very complex composition. And this complex composition forms during the heat treatment process of the base glass. Now, Photoville and Vitronit, they have a cabbage head or fluorogold type of morphology. And here you can see that kind of very different type of morphology of the crystals. And here again, this is an interlocking type of morphology of these mica crystals. Now, reasons for machinability, when you have interlock type of crystals like this shown as shown here. Now, when a machining cracks will come, they will interact with this interlock type of crystals. And then these crystals, they can break at some preferred cleavage plane here. And therefore, it gives more resistance to crack propagation in contrast to the fact than when you have a simple glass matrix itself. Now, the various precursor powders which are used to develop this glass ceramics, you start with the silica, alumina, magnesium oxide, K2O, B2O3, fluorine. So these are like, and then fluorine, you use that NH4F precursor. For B2O3, you use that boric acid as a precursor. And these cases, that composition of these glass ceramic materials, they vary like over wide range, like 46% silica gel, 16% alumina, 17% magnesium oxide, 10% K2CO3, which will finally give rise to K2O, then 7% boric oxide, B2O3, and 4% NH4F, that is the fluorine. Now, how these glass ceramic materials, they are processed? They are processed like, you start with the base glass, which is prepared after quenching from 1500 degrees Celsius. So you first heat it to, you first mix these powders, and then heat them to high temperature, they will melt. And this heating is done in platinum crucible, so that it does not react with that other crucible. Like if you use the alumina, then it will react with alumina. So you cannot use alumina, so platinum is more noble, so it does not react with this glass ceramic melt. So after you melt, then you can cast it, and then you make a base glass, then you grind it again, then again you remelt. So melting and remelting is done 2 to 3 times. Why? Because it is a multi-component system. If you do melting once, then all this glass composition may not be homogeneously distributed. So if you do melting and remelting twice or thrice, then that will essentially facilitate good mixing up in this multi-component system. Then you can do the single stage crystallization heat treatment, and this heat treatment can be done at 1000 to 1120 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. And then other case, you can do this heat treatment from 8 to 24 hours time scale. So in one case you are changing the time temperature, in other case you are changing the time. Now this is your XRD spectra. What it shows that you have a base glass here, there is no crystalline peak. When you heat it at 1040 degrees Celsius, you do see the fluorophosphorite peak. If you heat it at 1120 degrees Celsius, you see fluorophosphorite peak as well as AM, that is the mullite peak. Now this is the microstructure typically what has been observed when you change the temperature. Like you start with the 1000 degrees Celsius, it is amorphous matrix. You heat it at 1120 degrees Celsius for 4 hours. What you see here, these microcrystals, they form. 1120 degrees Celsius, similar microcrystals form, and then you can see that is interlocking type of crystals. At other temperature, 1040 and 1080, also you do see that interlocking type of crystals. The major difference is the volume fraction of the crystals that form. Now what you see at 1040 is around 50 to 60% volume percent. At around 1080 it is little less, or it is around 45% of crystals those are formed. Now in case when the time is varied for 8 hours to 24 hours, then what you notice here that in the 8 hours and subsequently higher time, you do see that some kind of butterfly type of crystals. Why do I say butterfly? Because it has a very characteristically shaped crystals which are generated from central nucleus. You can see more such crystals here. Let's say this is your starting point. So this is like nucleus, and from this nucleus, these crystals, they are growing at different directions, and these crystals are growing at different directions, and subsequently they are like enclosed in a large spherical shaped area which is called crystal domain. Now if you look at these crystals more carefully, what you notice, they also have a tree leaf type of patterns. Tree leaves, like, you know, you have one main branch and from that other branches are also formed, and this is a very fascinating type of crystals. And these crystals are only formed when you change the time or when you vary the time. Now what are the possible mechanism? Possible mechanism is that when the crystals are nucleated from the amorphous glass matrix, and if there is fine scale perturbation in the nucleus glass matrix, so these perturbations will subsequently develop some kind of dendrites here, and these dendrites will grow in the glass matrix, and from these dendrites, primary dendrites, you also have secondary dendrites, and these secondary dendrites are also growing in this glass matrix, and as a result you form more like a tree leaf type of pattern, and that what we call as a butterfly type of crystals. Now in the literature, these kind of crystals are also known as spherulite dendritic type of crystals. Now what we believe, when you do this heat treatment at different time scale at the same temperature of 1000 degrees Celsius, let's say, now when you are heated at 4 hours, then some volume fraction of the glass will be occupied of this spherulite dendritic type of crystals. If you do stage wise more and more time, if you allow more and more time for this glass ceramic to spend at the 1000 degrees Celsius up to 24 hours, then you can get more densely packed crystals, and where this growth of one butterfly crystals will be stopped as soon as it impinges on the other butterfly crystals. Now some comments on the hardness property of these materials. Now what you see as far as the hardness property is concerned, at 1040 4 hours, 1080 and 1120 4 hours, when you vary the temperature, the hardness of these materials, which is the shaded bar, and these materials has a hardness little higher than 5 gigapascal. Now 5 gigapascal is not a bad number, it is actually a good value as far as the glass ceramics are concerned. Now what you notice here, that although the indents are very sharp in these glass ceramics, but they do show extensive crack propagation because of the brittleness, and also there is fractures observed as this indent will also interact with these mica glass mica crystals. Now, in order to assess that whether these glass ceramic materials, they do have good in vitro biomineralization property, and this was assessed by immersing them in the artificial saliva. Now, artificial saliva actually closely simulate the oral environment. Oral environment means inside the mouth, what is the content of this aqueous environment, that is what has been mimicked by artificial saliva. Now, what is this environment they look like? You have the NaCl, you have KCl, you have calcium chloride, NH2PO4, you have Na2S, urea and distilled water. Now, this composition has been taken from the textbook and other literature, and then we have done this testing up to 42 days, so that means 6 weeks. And then we have selected, based on the mechanical properties and the microstructure, we have selected a few samples which are first further tested in artificial saliva. Now, what you notice here in the after this artificial saliva testing, that for the 1080 degrees Celsius 4 hours, you do notice these crystals which are brighter in contrast. And when you take this EDAC spectra from this brighter crystal, then you see calcium peak as well as phosphorus peak. The presence of the strong calcium and phosphorus peak essentially tells you they are like calcium phosphate rich phase. Now, similar things what we also notice at the other materials, that also you have a bright appearing crystal phases which are not present prior to the in vitro dissolution. Now, this leaching of the ions is important, as I mentioned during the discussion on the in vivo test, that both the in vivo biodegradation and in vitro biomineralization are equally important. That means some materials can be always leached out from the biomaterial depending on the composition of the biomaterial. Now, here you can see that how this fluoride ion, they are getting leached from this material. This fluorine ion, they are reached up to 0.1 ppm or around 0.1 ppm, that is the maximum, and it is less than 0.1 ppm. According to the WHO standards, that is the World Health Organization, this fluorine ion which can be tolerated in the solution, or the leaching of fluorine ion that can be tolerated in the solution, is 1.5 ppm. So, the amount of fluorine ion which is leached from our materials, which is much, much less than that what is recommended by WHO. So, therefore, these glass ceramic materials, although they are tested up to 42 days, this fluorine ion leaching cannot cause any additional concern. The other things, that is the potassium ion concentration. Now, potassium, your starting solution has somewhere this level, and after 7 days or 42 days, even 6 weeks, there is not much increase in the potassium ion concentration. That means this potassium ion is not released to a large extent. As far as the magnesium ion concentration is concerned, your magnesium ion is roughly less than 2 mg per liter, and it decreases at 42 days. So, the other important thing that you notice in calcium ion concentration. Now, calcium ion in the solution was much higher, but after 7 days and after 42 days, calcium ion concentration largely reduced from the starting solution. What it means? This means that this calcium ion, they forms calcium phosphate on the material, and therefore from the solution calcium ion content is reduced. Now, in the next set of experiments, what we have done in these glass ceramics is that we have varied the fluoride ion concentration, and by varying the fluoride ion concentration, we are trying to see that whether this changing in the base glass composition will have any important effect as far as the hardness property is concerned, as far as the biocompatibility property is concerned, or as far as the cellular adhesion property is concerned. And this, by changing the fluorine ion over 1 to 4%, that other amount of this, the other oxides are also varied in a relatively narrow window. Now, the same protocol has been used to fabricate these materials, that is the preparation of the glass batch and melting at 1550 degrees Celsius for 2 hours. So, typically this melting was done in platinum crucible, and then as I explained to you just few minutes back, that melting and remelting were carried out all together, and therefore to homogenize this mixture, this or to ensure homogeneity as far as the composition of the base glass is concerned. After that, they are all quenched in water, basically they are cast into the mold, and then you can take out this base glass, and then you can further anneal this glass at 610 degrees Celsius to reduce any thermal induced stresses. Then you can cut, grind, and then after that each pieces you can ceramize. Ceramize means this is a heat treatment which will essentially form that ceramic particles in the glass matrix. That is why it is called as glass ceramic material. And then we can characterize the mechanical and microstructure properties, and subsequently in vitro and in vivo properties were characterized. So these glass ceramic materials which are heat treated at different temperature, right from 1000 degrees Celsius to 1120 degrees Celsius. Now what you notice here, that at base glass this is a very broad amorphous peak, so it is essentially pure glass. So this amorphous nature or broadness of the peak essentially tells you that it is a pure glass phase. Now when you heat it at 1000 degree to 1120 for 12 hours, then you see the characteristic sharp peak of the fluoroflogopite. So F stands for fluoroflogopite, and this is that characteristic crystalline phase which forms, and you do see that it forms right at 1000 degrees Celsius. Now we have done this FTIR, and that is the Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. Now what you see in the FTIR, you do notice that there is a BO stretching peak, you have a SiO bond peak, and you have a SiO Si peak. So all these different type of peaks FTIR bands are observed in different glass ceramics from M1, M2, M3, essentially tells you that different chemical bondings which are present in this glass ceramic materials. Now as far as the crystal volume fraction is concerned, these materials contains the crystals up to 60 to 70%, 70 volume percent of the crystals. And as far as the hardness is concerned, these materials have a very good hardness values which is around 8 gigapascal. Now 8 gigapascal to roughly 4 gigapascal, that is the hardness values they are measured in this glass ceramic materials. To obtain reliable hardness properties, what we have done on the Vickers hardness were also observed in the scanning electron microscope. Then you can calculate with more accuracy and precision the Vickers diagonal, and then thereby determine these hardness properties. Now if you compare the properties of this glass ceramic materials with the other existing materials, what we notice here, that either mica based apatite glass ceramic or MGC glass ceramic or dental enamel, they have the hardness values which is less than 5 gigapascal. At the same time, you have these hardness values which is 8 gigapascal or 6 to 8 gigapascal, which were observed in our glass ceramics by varying this fluorine content. So therefore, these values are much better than those of the earlier developed materials which are already reported in the literature. Other things that you notice, that in our glass ceramic materials, elastic modulus is somewhere 57 to 70 gigapascal, and your cortical bone elastic modulus is around up to 3 to 80 gigapascal. So our glass ceramic materials, they have the elastic modulus which is just sufficient for the cortical bone replacement or heart tissue replacement. As far as the strength properties concerned, one can get strength in these materials up to 95 megapascal, and 95 megapascal strength is quite good as far as that if you consider the other materials which is 40 to 60 or 215 megapascal is concerned. Now these materials which are developed by varying this fluorine content in this glass ceramics, important things that you can notice is that this kind of glass domain, crystal domain, and in this individual crystal domain, the crystals are oriented differently, and they are like much like rod like structure, and these rods, they experience anisotropic growth, and anisotropic growth has been shown also here. The more interestingly, the high magnification SM image tells you that these glass ceramic materials, they have a what we call envelope type of crystals. If you remember the postal envelope, in this postal envelope they also have typical this kind of shape, and in individual envelope you have these glass ceramic crystals, and these ceramic crystals, they are oriented differently in different directions, and therefore these crystal domains, they meet at a particular location here and thereby forming that envelope like crystals. In vitro property, we have carried out again this in vitro dissolution test in this artificial saliva. And in this artificial saliva, as I mentioned earlier, the composition of artificial saliva, after 3 weeks, we do see the signs of CAP-like layer formation. After 6 weeks or 42 days, you can see this calcium phosphate rich precipitates are formed over uniformly and homogeneously over the entire surface, and thereby the CAP rich layer formation essentially indicates good biomineralization ability of these materials. As far as the in vitro leaching is concerned, in the fluorine ion concentration, in the when it goes to up to 7 or 8 weeks, again your fluorine ion leaching is much less than the WHO recommended value, and this value is even less than 0.1 by ppm. As far as the potassium and magnesium and concentration, it shows a systematically decreased value with the potassium concentration if you go from week 1 to week 8, and similarly magnesium and concentration, it shows more or less systematically increased values as you go from W1 to W8. What it means, that means magnesium concentration is getting increased, or magnesium is more leached from the solution, whereas potassium concentration, it goes on decreasing with more time of leaching in the solution. Now some friction and wire experiments were carried out in these materials in artificial saliva, and there this ball and flat type of configuration is used. So this is a ball and this is your flat. So flat is your glass ceramic, and this is a typical fretting wire setup where you can continuously measure the frictional force. And if you see the frictional force, how they will evolve in this glass ceramic materials, in the case of dry, which is this dry COF, which is around 0.7. In the artificial saliva also, the average COF is 0.7. So there is not much difference in the dry condition and the artificial saliva condition. As far as the wear rate is concerned, we do see a interesting trend. Like you start with the 5,000 cycles, and to the more number of cycles, like up to 100,000 cycles. Now what you notice here, in the dry case also wear rate decreases, and the artificial saliva case also wear rate decreases. And each time duration, the artificial saliva glass ceramic materials were less as compared to dry conditions. Now that will be clear when you look at the worn surfaces. Now all these worn surfaces were taken after the artificial saliva testing. And this after artificial saliva testing, after 5,000 fretting cycles, what you notice here, that there is a tribochemical layer formation, and this tribochemical layer formation, it is formed over the entire worn surface, thereby protecting the surface. And after 50,000 cycles, we do see this tribal layer, but there is extensive cracking, and this cracking essentially can potentially spoil these materials out of the system, so thereby exposing the underlying material to further wear. Now coming to the in vitro cell compatibility testing or cytocompatibility testing, we have used that SOS2 cell lines. SOS2 cell lines is that human osteoblast-like cells, and these osteoblast-like cells were seeded for 24 hours on these materials. Now this is your control sample. These cells are cell-to-cellular network formed, and this is an extensive phylopodia extension, and this is one cell, this is another cell, and this is phylopodia extension from this cell, this phylopodia extension from that cell, and there is a cellular bridge formation. And as you can see, that is some collagen-like layer formation, that is the ECM formation also in these materials when they are seeded for 24 hours. As far as the MTT assay is concerned, that is the cell viability testing for L929 cells, that is the mouse fibroblast cells, what you see here, after 2 days, 4 days and 6 days culture, there is a significant difference in this MTT culture, MTT values compared to the control. Similar difference is also observed in the 4 days culture, and after 6 days culture, they are more or less comparable. So what I am trying to emphasize here, by varying the fluorine content, you do not compromise much on the biocompatibility property or cell viability property, because you do see similar kind of MTT-OD values, that is optical density values, both after 2 days, 4 days and 6 days, with some cases having some statistically significantly different values. As per the ALP expression, that is the alkaline phosphatase activity concerned, now in M1 to M3, we do see that from the control to M1, M2 and M3, in both the cases corresponding to the control specimen, you do have significant, statistically significant difference. Now other thing is that you can notice that in the case of M1, the osteogenic differentiation value is quite large, M2 and M3 it is comparable. So what you see, that at lower, this is the 1.05% fluorine. So So at lower fluorine content, your osteogenic differentiation is more expressed, or it has much more value compared to other glass ceramic composition. As far as the antimicrobial properties concerned, we have seeded the Staphylococcus epidermidis, that is the gram-positive bacteria, for 4 hours on this glass ceramic materials. You can see very significant colony formation at different places in the control sample. Such colony formation is largely reduced. This is M2 and this is M3, with few bacteria only forming some clusters here and there, but this is certainly much improved in M2 and M3, whereas in M1 we do notice some aggregation of bacteria at different pockets in this microstructure region. Similar observations were also made in case of the Escherichia coli, that E. coli bacteria, after 4 hours of incubation. In the control sample, you do notice that large aggregates or large colony of the bacteria that is formed. At M3 surface, there's much less number of bacteria compared to this is M1 or this is M2. So M2 here is shown, does not show much improvement in antimicrobial property compared to M3 or M1 per se. The UV visible spectrophotometry values, that is optical density values, tells you that in the control sample you have that very strong, the lack of any antimicrobial activity, whereas M1, M2, M3 have significant statistically different value compared to the control sample. And from these values you can say that M1, M2, M3, they are both equally having antimicrobial property. So I think I'll stop here, and then in the next lecture I'll start with other recent topics.